I'm really happy that Michael Dio is with us today, and especially happy that he's able to give this talk and complete our lecture series. Michael got his degree in mathematics from Washington University in St. Louis, and somewhere in there, while he was getting his degree in mathematics, he realized he really liked psychology, thought that was exciting. And so he would eventually enter the clinical psychology program at the University of Texas at Austin. And while there, he got interested in genetics, behavior genetics, and Michael first entered into my consciousness. I remember reading in the early 1990s an interview in Science magazine with this young man who, with his mentor, had shown that identical twins are more often concordant for sexual orientation than fraternal twins. And I can tell you, and the implication being that there's some genetic propensity towards homosexuality. And I can tell you that at that time, some of you I know weren't born yet or weren't reading the newspapers, at the time this was seen as really controversial stuff. And as often happens with behavior genetic results, it was widely misunderstood by people on both sides of the issue of gay rights. But it was really a fascinating finding, and I think that sort of put him on a trajectory to, while he studies many things, I think that's been a continuing interest for Mike in the years since, this question of why not all people are attracted to people of the opposite sex. So I don't want to take up much more of his time, but just to say that I feel delighted to have him here, and really excited that we'll have a real expert to talk to us about these issues. So welcome, please, Michael Bailey.
I'm delighted to be here, and after my accident, I'm delighted to be here. Really been looking forward to this. I was disappointed when I thought it might not work out, but thank you, Mark. So I'm going to be addressing this question, which is put about as clearly as it is often discussed. And I'm going to start by an exercise, or I'm going to work in an exercise, and you can decide whether it's an exercise in pedantry or actual clarification. And my motive is that I believe that speaking clearly facilitates thinking clearly. So I want to consider a taxonomy of causal explanations, and I want to pare it down and organize and so on. If you talk about the origins of sexual orientation, people tend to treat all of these words as synonyms. And they're complements also as synonyms. And I think some of these words mean different things than other words in the same column, and I think some of these words shouldn't be used at all, and I'll try to persuade you of that. sorry. Now, one synonym, or one couple of synonyms that tend to go with these are these assumptions that if something is on the left-hand column, that means that homosexuality in particular is okay and acceptable, and if it's on the right, then it's not okay. So let's start with considering this question: causal explanations of sexual orientation have moral or ethical consequences? The answer is no. And here's why. What determines the social or ethical desirability of a trait? It's not the causes of the trait, it's the consequences of the trait. And whether a trait is genetic or environmental, learned or innate, is utterly irrelevant to its social and ethical desirability. And so I think, you know, the study of the causes of sexual orientation is fascinating and important, but not for this reason. It's fascinating and important for intrinsic scientific reasons. Everybody should be, I think everybody is interested in the question. But I didn't always think this way. After my first twin study that Mark alluded to, I wrote an op-ed for the New York Times and had that sentence in there. And Alice Drager, you've been wanting to hear me say this. I was wrong. I changed my mind. Okay, so it's possible. It's possible. Okay, that those connotations do not belong. So let's shift to the first pair of words in there. These are probably the most common words that lay people use, and scientists also use them, which is biological versus chosen. Biological, that word I think really shouldn't be used in a thoughtful discussion, because all behavior is biological. As you listen to me, and I'm not operating on your brains or genes or anything directly, your brains are doing stuff like that, not really activating in this exact way, because that's the activity of men looking at porn, but something like that. I am affecting your brains. All behavior is biological, and it all goes through the brain. Where else would it go? So let's consider the word chosen. Is homosexuality a choice? Interesting that this question, this word, seems to be associated with sexual orientation per se. For example, do you ever hear, is schizophrenia a choice? Is high intelligence a choice? Never hear that. You hear, is homosexuality a choice? What's up with that? I think that it's due to some kind of confusion, of which there might be at least three types. One is easily resolved. Famous philosopher Schopenhauer said, a man can do what he wants, but not want what he wants. So if by sexual orientation we're talking about feelings, desire for other people, you can't choose that. You can't choose what you want, your feelings. The sentence, I choose to prefer having sex with women rather than men, does that even make sense? No. But given one's feelings, of course, one can choose one's behavior. But most of us use sexual orientation to mean feelings, so no, you can't choose your sexual orientation. There are a couple of other senses of choice that may be involved in this, the use of this word. One is free will versus determinism, that old philosophical debate. I'll just tell you, there is no free will. And if you disagree, you had no choice but to disagree. And in any case, talking about choice in this sense isn't very fruitful. And the other is bisexuality. So bisexuals like both men and women. In that sense, maybe they have more of a choice whom to be with than what we call monosexuals, people who are strongly attracted to one sex but not at all to the other. Anyway, I think that the use of choice is a vague, unclear sort of usage, and it doesn't help the quality of academic debate. And so I'd like to get rid of both of these words, and I hope you will too, at least in this context. So let's take the second pair, natural versus unnatural, often used in the following context. Do non-human animals do it? If so, it's natural. Otherwise, it's unnatural. Does it make evolutionary sense? If so, it's natural. And always the connotation that natural is good and unnatural is bad. In the first context up here, non-human animals, we've had works like this one, which is about homosexuality in the non-human animal world. And of course, Chuck Roselli came here to talk about the gay rams, and both homosexual behavior and more rarely homosexual orientation do occur in the non-human animal world. that's interesting, but it really means something else than the debate that my title has framed. And talk about unnatural things that never occur in the animal world. Very, very unnatural. Okay. So back into the other senses here. Does it make evolutionary sense and good versus bad? Well, these phenomena all make plenty of evolutionary sense that we have really good explanations for them. And we wouldn't agree, I think, that any of them is a good thing. So there's really no correlation between something being natural and good. And so also I'd like to get rid of these two words. So what's left over, I think the rest of these words do make some sense and are worth talking about, and they're not all distinct. So I think that these words all belong in the same debate, as do these. These belong in a different debate, but belong together. And finally, this one. And we'll start at the bottom, essentialist versus socially constructed. These words come from the humanities, and I've been skeptical how much the humanities can add to science, but at least in scientific debates. But this is one place where I think that they have. And the sense in which it's used is a category like gay or straight, an essential feature of the human condition, or is it constructed by some societies but not others? And the way one might think about this thought experiment is, imagine you had a time machine that can also take you to different cultures. And you could take a person, ideally take a newborn baby, who, let's say in this culture, will grow up to be a gay man. You take him to another time and place, and what will he turn out to be? And along with the time machine, you want to bring this, which is something to measure genital sexual arousal with. Both of these, if you've been coming to this series, you've seen both of these people. On the left, that's Meredith Chivers, and on the right, that's Paul Vasey. And first of all, having them on this slide reminds me to emphasize that the answer may differ between women and men. But they also do research that I think is very relevant here. So these findings are from Meredith Chivers' work on sexual arousal patterns. There's a big sex difference. So this is men. They get much more sexually aroused to the sex they're attracted to than to the sex that they say they're less attracted to. And in contrast, straight women genitally show a bisexual pattern. And I think that if we could take men and women to different cultures and do genital arousal, I doubt that would change. Now, I don't know, because we're still building our time machine, but that would be my bet. But some things do change across cultures. This is a Samoan fafafina that Paul studies. This is a genetic male who has taken this third gender role in Samoa. They appear outwardly to be female. They're a lot like feminine gay men, though, in some of their cultures. And I tease Paul that had he grown up in Samoa, he'd look and act like that, and he has never disagreed with me. And so I do think that there are some aspects of the presentation of the role of a gay man that are not essentialistic, but are socially constructed. Okay. So let's go here next to genes versus environment, and I'll start with the work that I started with. And before I tell you what we know, I'll just go over the logic of twin studies. And twins who are reared apart from birth are the best to study, but they're too rare to rely on because mothers are selfish and they do not routinely give up one of their twins to be adopted, even though they have two. We could know a lot more if mothers would do this, but they are selfish. Okay, so we do have to rely on twins who are reared together, but we are lucky that there are two kinds of twins. There are genetically identical twins, who are scientifically often called monozygotic, one egg, and fraternal twins, dizygotic, two-egg twins. And we assume that if they're reared together in the same family, that they're equally similar with respect to their rearing environment. They grew up in the same family. There are ways of challenging that, and if you want to, we can talk about that. But I think the evidence supports it. And the inference is that if genes matter, then identical twins should be more similar for a trait than fraternal twins. And in categorically assessed traits where you're not, it's not like height where you get a measurement, but you're either this or that, we look at twin concordance, which is basically a percentage of similarity. Concordance refers to this in this context. Given a gay twin, what is the probability or percentage chance that his co-twin is also gay? The earliest study of this was conducted by a guy named Franz Kalman, who worked in the early 50s in New York City. And you know, back in that time and place, homosexuality was taboo. It was something people hid. And he wrote in his article that he went to the gay underworld, or the homosexual underworld of New York City, looking for gay twins. Hey, bud, do you know any homosexual twins, basically? This is what he found. So he had male twins, 37 out of 37 monozygotic twins versus 3 out of 26 dizygotic twins. These are concordance percentages. That's really quite astounding. I mean, it looks from those numbers like, you know, it might be completely due to genes. There might be a major gene for homosexuality. I don't remember which year this was published, early to mid 50s, but no study this large had been conducted by the time I came on the scene in the early 90s. And so I had the goal of trying to replicate this somewhat different world in, let's say, 1990 when I began the study. There was still some stigma about homosexuality, but not nearly as much as in the 50s. I put this advertisement in homophile publications across the country. I don't think I advertised in Lansing, but East Lansing, but said, men, are you a twin or do you have an adoptive brother? An adoptive brother is a genetically unrelated male who was reared with the index subject, who is always gay. And we say, no, we will hope you will call regardless of the sexual orientation of your twin or adoptive brother. Of course, we hope that. Could we bank on it? Probably not. But here are our results compared with Kalman. So 52 for monozygotic twins against 22 for dizygotic. So one thing that we showed, without doubt, that genetics of sexual orientation are not complete. Environment matters. Even in our study here, we were concerned that these concordances might be higher than they would be if we could do the perfect study. which would involve, I don't know, so the perfect study would be to get, say, go to a large city and get every single high school senior, bring them to my lab, have them watch erotic videos and measure their genital arousal. Which do you think I'll be able to do first, the time machine or that one? So anyway, given the imperfection, that was the best I could do in 1991. But we were worried about this in particular, unequal ascertainment. Basically, is it plausible that gay twins, let's say, whose co-twins are also gay, are going to be more likely to contact us than gay twins whose co-twins are straight? Maybe because if their co-twins are gay, they don't worry about being outed, because a lot of twins didn't know that, or a lot of twins were not out to their straight co-twins and so on. There are ways of reducing this kind of bias, and they involve recruiting from sources other than the media, direct advertisement. For example, there have been probability studies which people have called random twins and asked them a bunch of questions, not just about sexuality. There are twin registries where some researcher has tried to get every twin born between certain dates in certain geographic locations to join a twin registry, which they can ask over and over to participate in scientific studies. So this compiles those samples, and I guess I would direct your attention down here. These are the medians across these less biased sources of recruitment, and these contain both men and male and female subjects. And you can see, still, the monozygote concordance is higher than the dizygote concordance, but these concordances are lower and there's less of a difference. To put it in context, I found this graph. Now, I didn't choose this because I think homosexuality is a psychiatric disorder. I do not. But because these are dichotomously diagnosed traits like homosexuality is. So these are rates for MZ concordance for these so-called psychiatric disorders. I don't know, reading disability, psychiatric disability. Anyway, and here's homosexuality put on there, the red bars here. And you see that's looks much different. These are lower concordances, and this difference is quite a bit lower. And I'm not going to talk about this today, but I kind of like this in a way, because I do believe in the theory of evolution. And I do think that homosexuality presents a problem for the theory of evolution, in particular the existence of strong genetic causation for a trait that makes somebody mate non-reproductively. It's a problem. So conclusions from twin studies. I believe these are supported. Monozygotic concordance is higher than dizygotic concordance, but the concordances are pretty low. Heritability probably is too. Heritability, you can't get directly from concordances. You have to assume some kind of genetic transmission model, like multifactorial inheritance or something, and then you have to do a model fitting and so on. And I am so uncertain about what the true concordances are, much less what the genetic transmission model is, I don't even bother computing heritability. Environment is important, exclamation mark. So I'm going to show you 1 minute film clip about a pair of identical twins of different sexual orientations, and I think they're the most interesting kind because they're genetically identical. These are reared together from birth, and yet they're so different in this fundamental way.
must be the answer. But then the researchers tell you identical twins can have different sexual orientations. We found Steve and Greg Ross in New York. As identical twins, they have the same upbringing, have the same DNA. And yet, Greg is gay, and Steve is straight.
When you meet people, and they find out you're gay and you're not, what do they say?
Are you sure? How can that be? Yeah, sure. Everyone is curious about that.
There were signs, even when they were little kids. Their mother told us Steve loved sports and the outdoors, while Greg liked helping out in the kitchen. But it wasn't until high school that Steve became convinced Greg was gay.
Did you say anything to him? Or?
I did, actually. I think the way I worded it was something like, you know, Greg, if you're gay, it's okay. I'll still love you the same. And he gave a very philosophical answer. He said something like, well, I love the soul of the person and not the physical being. And in my mind, I was like, yep, he's gay.
So one thing I'll point out is that nobody to date has done a study of these twins to bring them to the genital arousal assessment lab to make sure that the so-called straight twin is really straight. And I'd love to do such a study, but I think that there are indications that usually this is true. Very common to get that difference in memories of childhood, the gay one being more feminine as a boy than the straight one. So, you know, what kind of environment causes identical twins reared together from birth to have different sexual orientations? So the opposite of genetic is environment. What does environment mean? It means exactly that, the opposite or the complement of genetic. I think that it's common for people to associate environment with social influence. Now, social influence is one form of environment, but it's not the only form. And I think that increasingly scientists are aware of non-social environmental influences. So one dramatic example comes from studies of babies born with major anomalies of the brain, like anencephaly and hydrocephaly. So in the review that's been done of this, 17% of the time, if one identical twin is born with one of these major brain problems, the other twin, so 83% of the time, 83% of the time, if one is born with one of these problems, the other is normal. So this is some very dramatic prenatal environmental factor. What is it? I don't think we have any idea. But I certainly believe that it's not social, it's prenatal. And I don't have a problem believing that what causes discordance for homosexuality or heterosexuality is also like that. And we do know of one prenatal environmental factor that affects sexual orientation. One of your speakers told you about it, the fraternal birth order effect that Ray Blanchard talked about, in which men in a pedigree older, the more older brothers a male has, the more likely that he will be gay. And we know that this is not a social effect, because it depends upon how many genetic older brothers one has and not how many social older brothers one has. And it's also environmental. You know, your birth order is not a feature of your genes, so it must be a feature of your environment. So what is the relevant environment for sexual orientation? It seems to exert early influence. And I have this in parentheses, GID means gender identity disorder, discordance. I'll talk more about gender identity disorder and stuff like it later. But for now, I'll just say we're talking here about, let's say, little boys who want to be girls from early on. And science says, and I'll show you the citations soon, that most of them will grow up to be gay men. And I've talked to several mothers of identical twin pairs, one of whom has this condition, the other of whom is a typical little boy. And they've been like that as early as they could move. So this is an environmental effect that causes this discordance. It emerges very early. We don't know where it comes from. And also, I think the environmental effect is likely to differ between males and females. For males, environmental influence may be entirely non-social. I'd say, I'll even bet it is. For females, social environment may matter more than it does for males, anyway. So, talked about twin studies, talked about environment, talked about gene hunting. You know, doing a twin study can tell you that genes matter. It tells you nothing about which genes matter or what they're doing. In order to find that out, you've got to actually find genes. And the most famous study of this ilk that's ever been done is this one, published in 1993 by Dean Hamer in his lab at the National Cancer Institute, the NIH. And there's Dean, and this study became quite controversial, both for political reasons, because you had conservative politicians saying, what is somebody at the National Cancer Institute spending government money on this research for? And also scientifically, for reasons I won't really go into now. Hamer used the SIB pairs methodology. And I'll try to do this quick and dirty. So each one of these is a pedigree, father, mother, and each of these is a gay son. So the fathers and the mothers have two gay sons. That's how you got into Hamer's study. You had to be a gay man with a gay brother. At any genetic locus, the father has two alleles, the mother has two alleles, and these are genetic markers. And so the similarity of the brothers for these markers could range from zero, these two have none in common, all the way up to they could be identical at both of them. What Hamer did is to look all over the genome at these SIB pairs, focusing on the X chromosome, because he saw reasons to believe that this tended to run in the mother's family more than the father's family. Anyway, he looked for places where SIB pairs tended to share more of their genes than we would expect by chance. By chance, we would expect 50% allele sharing. And there was a portion of the X chromosome called XQ28 that he found excess allele sharing for. Big news, as I said, it became controversial. I, along with many people, doubted that it was true. I'm not accusing Dean Hamer of doing anything wrong. It's just that this kind of study has had a poor replication record, like lots of genetic studies. In the year 2000, won a grant, PI, a guy named Alan Sanders, to replicate and extend this study. Hamer had 40 pairs of gay brothers, and eventually we recruited 400 pairs of gay brothers. And recently Alan presented this poster at a scientific meeting, and here's the, if you can read fast, you can read the whole thing, and otherwise I'm going to point. Here's the poster, and this is the part that you should see. So we had over 400 pairs of gay brothers, and our second strongest linkage region was on chromosome X at XQ28. I didn't think we'd find it, but we did. We have support for the Hamer finding. If you like to look at, if you like to look at linkage graphs, here's what it looks like. There's XQ28, which is the second highest LOD score. So it looks like there might be something there, and we are doing more things with these data. So linkage analysis, which is what we were funded to do, even in the year 2000, was on its way out. It's a disfavored kind of method now. The what people have been doing in the decade or so since has been genome-wide association studies. We have collected the data so that we can do some of that too. For genome-wide association studies, you have to have a bunch of gay guys get their DNA, and you have to have a bunch of straight guys' DNA. And then you basically look for differences in their DNA. It's more straightforward than a linkage study. And so we have those kinds of data. I will say that this method may be on its way out too, because it has been generally disappointing finding genes that matter much for genetically complex traits, and surely homosexuality is one. And what people think might be the wave of the future is looking for rare variants. Genome-wide association studies depends on polymorphisms that are common. At least 5% of the population must have any polymorphism, whereas rare variants can be rare. So they can be a gene that is rare but has a large effect. And I think that that is maybe a plausible story for homosexuality. Now, even in Hamer's day, this kind of work raised ethical concerns, specifically the current concern about manipulating sexual orientation. Genetics is, I guess, what people fear the most. I think if you fear manipulating sexual orientation, genetics is not what you should be fearing, because genes for homosexual orientation are unlikely to be of large effect, and any one that is likely to be rare. I don't think that this will ever be a very plausible way to affect sexual orientation. In contrast, prenatal testing of markers of brain differentiation might work better, because I think that there is likely, it's likely that some, certainly male sexual orientation is determined before birth, and you can plausibly tell the brains of babies who will become gay males from those who will become straight males. Maybe one could have hormonal treatments, and I want to emphasize, not saying that would be a good thing, but plausibly. So back to the controversy. It's from a course I found online. Just let you read that. This was a play that I think was also a movie, neither of which I understand was very good, but it was about this scenario in which a gene was discovered, and so the main character was a gay man. His sister got pregnant. Sure enough, she carried the gene. And the denouement, she elected to have an abortion, and as a result became sterile, you know, one of those tragic justice kinds of things. But anyway, the possibility that scientific findings may help parents avoid having a homosexual child is real, if not imminent. What should we do? Should we stop the research? Make researchers sign pledges. Dean Hamer offered to sign a pledge and to try to get government to outlaw that kind of thing. What should we do? Well, I thought a lot about this because people were saying that I should stop doing my research. And I, you know, I'm very gay positive and I didn't want to hurt gay people. I thought about it. I co-authored this article, Parental Selection of Children's Sexual Orientation. Again, if you can read quickly, you can read the abstract. But otherwise, I'll tell you the gist. So first, we argued that there is no good reason to dislike gay people. But if technology were available to ensure that a child will be heterosexual rather than homosexual without harming an actual child, no killing babies, for example, this decision should be up to the parents, even if the parents are prejudiced jerks, because we let parents do all kinds of things out of motives we don't agree with. That's, you know, part of being in a democracy and so on. This guy is named Tim Murphy. He's a gay bioethicist at the University of Illinois at Chicago, and in this book, he took Aaron Greenberg and me to task, not because he disagreed with us, but because he said he had said the same thing before we did and we didn't cite him. So feel free to write Tim and, you know, complain to Tim, complain to me, whatever. Okay, so now let's go to this set of words, which I think go together. I tend to prefer the word innate. Mark doesn't like innate. Innate versus socialized, but any of them kind of gets at the same thing, I think. And it's different than this because something can be, I think, inborn without being genetic. So for example, in the major brain anomalies, twins born with these major brain anomalies, that's inborn, but it wasn't all that genetic because you had lots of discordant pairs. So that's a little boy who at about 11 months old has taken a strong fascination with his mother's shoes. This is not a one-time thing. He's obsessed with these shoes. And here he is a few years later on the left. He wants to be a girl. And that's his typical brother over here. You would say this boy has extreme gender nonconformity. At the time, he would be diagnosed as gender identity disorder of childhood because he wanted to be a girl. So I'm talking about sexual orientation in this talk, this series, and not gender identity. And there's a reason why I show you that picture, because what usually happens to boys like the one on the left is he will probably grow up to be a gay man and not a transsexual adult. And a lot of gay men say, well, okay, but I wasn't like that. Well, we've studied the memories of more typical gay men and straight men, and we've asked them about their memories of childhood gender nonconformity, and we find large differences in the memories such that homosexual adults remember being more gender nonconforming in childhood compared with heterosexual adults. So childhood gender nonconformity appears to be common, if not universal, among homosexual people. This is a website that I encourage you to visit. It's born this way. It's a place where gay and lesbian adults can post pictures from their childhood. Here's one that I like. What do you mean came out? He was never in. My mom's caption for this picture on Facebook. So why am I talking about childhood gender nonconformity in this context? Because I think that it is strongly suggestive of innate development. Why? Well, first of all, it often, usually happens very early. Very early. And second, most parents of children with childhood gender nonconformity are not encouraging this, at least at first. it seems to come from within the child and not from the child's social environment. So strongly suggestive, but not proof. Here's better proof. This is the cover of a fascinating book that is an identical twin who has an identical twin brother. She used to be a boy, but a doctor destroyed the boy's penis in an accident, surgical accident, and the decision was made to raise that child as a girl because it was thought that you can't let a boy grow up without a penis. It was a fascinating and somewhat tragic story, but for the purposes of this talk, what's important is that as an adult, this individual was attracted exclusively to women, despite being reared from a very early age as a girl. And that is a pattern. So that case was this one. A similar case out of Canada. Both of these are Canadian cases. I don't know what it is with those Canadian surgeons. But in both cases, these adults are strongly attracted to women and not to men. And then this is a follow-up of people born with cloacal extrophy, which is a massive birth defect, which for a generation or so was treated with reassigning boys to be girls. In all six published cases, these are all hormonally normal males reassigned early as females, sexual orientation was toward females. And I think that this is proof positive about the origins of male sexual orientation. And things may well be different for women. We've got a lot of work to do there. I want to thank you, and also and that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. So we have time for questions. We don't have a microphone to give you, so if you have a question, speak up, and maybe, Mike, maybe you can reprise the question.
Okay. So I have two questions that I can remember. The first question is, in one of the pages that passed by, it said that there were 410 pairs of brothers from 385 families. Was that multiple pairs from the same nuclear family, or is that like cousins that were there? There's one pair and another pair that were closely related. Why are there more pairs than families?
Because there are more pairs than families because some families have three gay brothers. Three gay brothers allow three pairs, okay. I believe. Yeah.
Okay. And then my other question is, in terms of rare variants, is that like there's a bunch of different rare individual variants as opposed to a common gene, and they all do like the same thing of causing, for example, male homosexuality, and it's common for there to be a rare variant, but each particular variant is different? Is that what you're getting at?
That, well said, yeah. Rare variants would be distinct mutations, but they would very plausibly work through the same common biochemical pathway. It works more plausibly evolutionarily because, you know, mutations happen. But if a mutation is very common, we have to explain how it got get so common.
How does 5-alpha reductase deficiency, penis at 12 syndrome, fit into your thinking? They're raised as girls, they don't have a penis, but originally a very small one. And then when an alternative site of dihydrotestosterone appears in puberty, they switch over.
Well, okay, remember I meant to talk mainly about sexual orientation, and I think you're asking about gender identity, but I can speculate.
The last part of your talk, I mean.
Okay, yeah. So 5-alpha reductase deficiency. 5-alpha reductase is an enzyme needed to masculinize the genitalia. The
just
penis.
The external, yeah.
Right, but so as I understand it, and we have people in here who know a lot more about this than I do, we think that it still has, they're still masculinized in the brain to the extent that normal males are. And so whatever innate male development to the brain happens with them. And so you hear stories about these kids saying, you know, I always knew I was a boy. And my understanding is that when puberty happens and they virilize, that they are generally attracted to women and not to men.
So just this morning, apparently, Hillary Clinton, who you might think of as the leading contender for the presidency in 2016, depending on who's talking to whom, makes some national statement in favor of gay marriage. Right? And you think of where we would have been even 4 years ago, and that would have been unthinkable. And so the evolution of this has been so fast that even in your talk, there are chunks that are sort of anachronistic. And I mean that in the nicest. Right. So the whole question of, you know, should we worry about the research leading to, you know, it just doesn't look like it's going to be an issue in the nature of, you know, natural versus unnatural.
I agree that a lot of this does seem anachronistic. Although I'll remind us, we're at a university campus and. You know, there are, somebody, a friend of mine just sent me a news story. I don't know how many of you have heard of a singer named Michelle Schacht, who used to be kind of a radical, I think maybe she was a lesbian or something, and she just she had an outburst at some conference, or not conference, concert, and she said, I think seriously, she said, God hates fags. And there are people who say that. And, you know, I totally agree. I think we're going toward where we are and not back the other way. But we do have to be aware that there are forces in opposition.
So I hate to make you withdraw that you were wrong, but I think you were wrong, but you were wrong. Could you go back to that slide?
I don't know, which is harder to believe, that I said this or that you said that.
Could you go back to that slide?
I will, yeah. I will.
Yeah, but be careful when you show her the slide, she may decide, oh no, you were wrong.
So you said, if true, a biological explanation is good news for homosexuals and their advocates. So the sociological data early on told us that people did not change their minds about gay rights based on whether or not they believed being gay is inborn. But now it looks like maybe it is the case that a biological explanation is in fact good news. And so if we take your statement as descriptive, it looks like you might have been right.
Alice, you are right. I was right. What could I have been thinking that I said I was wrong?
That you said you're
wrong.
That's so great. So you can tell people, I did make a mistake once, but then I realized later that I was right.
I thought I was wrong, yeah. Well, okay, that's a really good point. But and it is, I think it is both true that saying that sexual orientation is inborn tends to make people feel better about homosexuality. That is true. It's also true that that is an illegitimate strategy that I've seen people take, and I don't do it anymore, I guess. I did it.
You'd rather see homophobia fade for the right reasons rather
That's
than
right.
the wrong reasons.
But I think that it's maybe not surprising that it switches because the culture changes in its views of how we value science and whether science is something that's being used for any purpose, for something that's for the greater good or something that's not. So, you know.
I think what's interesting, of course, is the number of pedophile activists who are beginning to latch onto the born this way argument. And I mean, I think it's pretty clear that's not going to win, right?
Yeah.
So it'll be interesting to see those play off of each other.
And it sort of shows the illegitimacy of that line of thinking.
Absolutely.
about sexual reasons.
Yeah, although, you know, what does, I think, it depends on what they're trying to do. If they're trying to get with kids, it's not going to work. But if they're trying to say, look, I can't help having these feelings, I'm not going to act on it, then I think it can help and should help.
Or especially, I have these feelings and I don't want to act on them, and I would like to seek help to make sure I never act on them, and I would rather not be arrested for
yeah.
trying to seek help, right? which is the case in many jurisdictions, where there's a certain amount of risk that such a person will be arrested for trying to make sure they never hurt anyone. It's very complex.
Someone else who was here was making argument about that same topic, about having pressures to change your sexual orientation, and people who are pedophiles, obviously there's huge social pressure to not have that orientation, but yet it still happens, just basically like what you were saying, if males, you know, if growing up in this really homophobic cultures, it still happens, yeah. So.
Yeah, I think pedophilic men, their sexual orientation is just as inborn as heterosexual men or homosexual men, but they have much more reason never to act on their feelings.
Yeah, so just like the religious types of associations or people who have like these schools or ways to change people's sexual orientation, it just kind of goes to show that really no matter how much social pressure you have, that kind of thing, just...
You can't change people's feelings. I think the data are pretty clear, but you can affect whether people act on it. And that's actually part of the, maybe the tragedy of those kinds of influences with respect to gay and lesbian people, that I think actually some of these schools do prevent them from living the kind of life that would make them most happy.
A number of times during the talk, you sort of said, I think it might be different for women. What's your assessment of the state of research for women?
Well, I think, you know, it's lagged behind, maybe in part for the usual reasons. It's lagged behind also because women's sexual orientation makes less sense than men's does, to me anyway. You know, it's less clear what sexual orientation means for women than for men. You know, we can, you know, the following sentence makes sense for men. That guy was lying about his sexual orientation. We could bring that guy to my lab, assess him, you know, kind of find out, I think, his true sexual orientation. I don't think that we can do that for women, among other things. So I think we still don't really know what women's sexual orientation is, and until we understand that better, we can't make as much progress.
How about one more question? I saw someone back there.
Just
so,
the only question.
Oh, all right. Well, I said I'd take one more.
So I'm wondering, you just said that you could take a male back and find out what his true sexual orientation is. Have you ever had anyone who's claimed to be one way, but then you figured out was the other based on the data, and then did you tell them? And if so, what was their reaction?
I can answer one of those questions. And the first one, yes, I can remember two subjects that we've had in which they said that they were straight and they came to the lab and got erections to male stimuli and not to female stimuli. I remember one of them, so, you know, okay, did I want to say, come on, yes, did I say that? No. But I do think that we, yeah, no, that's all I'll say.
Yeah, I just had one quick question. With the genetic studies that are either happening or are planned in the future, it kind of seems like there may be more than one type of population of homosexual men. So like you were saying, men who are homosexual due to the fraternal birth order, that's an environmental action going on there. But then you have these, obviously, other populations that do have some sort of genetic influence on the orientation. So is there any concern about what data you're gathering, like you might be getting from different populations of homosexual men?
Sure, and genetic studies have to worry about that. For example, in terms of ethnic differences, you have to make sure that you collect good ethnic differences because there might be different genes that work within different ethnicities. But just to clarify one thing, the fact that fraternal birth order is definitely a cause, and genes may be a cause, and prenatal hormones may be a cause, doesn't necessarily mean that there are different types of gay men, because it may be that the cause of homosexual orientation works through one final common pathway, the degree of masculinization or feminization of the okay, for example, yeah.
Right, right.
It's just that different things can masculinize that or feminize that. That is a possibility. It might also be that there are different kinds of gay men, but I would reserve that hypothesis for gay men who are phenotypically different from each other, that actually look or act or...
Well, maybe just different populations for the mechanism that gets them.
Yeah. Sure. Sure.
So I'll intervene and ask one. So now that you're convinced there is some gene in the Q28 region of the X chromosome that seems to have some influence on sexual orientation, at least in males, what's the likelihood that anyone could pinpoint which particular gene? So I assume that there's a lot of genes in this area, about 100 more. And is anyone going to try to look at your data to try to look for alleles of particular genes?
And
see whether they co-vary with sexual orientation.
Yeah, our data are not likely to be. We don't have enough data to do a lot of that. The successful gene finding using genome-wide association, for example, has maybe had 5,000. Cases, which would be gay men, 5,000 controls, that would be straight men, that order. And we just don't have that many. And who will NIH fund that? I don't know. I can't believe they funded us to do what we did. And maybe just people will be interested enough. It's getting cheaper and cheaper to do these genetic studies.
So thank you, everyone.
Thanks a lot.